Welcome to Hangtail Survival. My name's Robert, and in this video, we're going to talk about the four dog stove. This is the Titanium Deluxe One. It's a 10 by 10 by 18. Okay, what I'll do is take this thermometer. Outdoors is 37 degrees and 39% humidity. I'll put this in this dry sack so the humidity doesn't get to it. Tighten it up, and then we'll leave it outside. Okay, there's the stove pipe in the stove jack. That's a 4-inch stove jack hole and a 3-inch pipe. That gives me a lot of play to be able to install it and take it out. You can see here, I've got it on the ground. It's always good to have enough pipe to where you could actually set your pipe on the ground and it not fall out of your stove jack, so that in case you have an emergency, you can take your stove jack off, put it on the ground, and then take the firebox and get it out. I've snow floated this. You can see I'm on two sticks, and they're in the base of the firebox, but you surely want to be able to have a stove pipe that, as the snow melts, that the stove pipe is able to come straight down. I installed it in the center, one, because I wanted to only install one stove jack into the tent, but also I wanted to be able to have the stove pipe as close to the pole as I could, because I'll hang stuff on this pole to dry off. It also gives me the backs of about a radiant surface area on the pipe being in the center. It also faces the front of the tent so that I can get fresh air into the front of the firebox, and I can also put my wood and stuff in the area that we enter the tent. I only open at the bottom, so I want to make sure I always have fresh air. So I'll either open that all the way up, or this vent here, it faces the wind and it will always get nice fresh air in if I need to. Put another thermometer right here. We've got one outdoor. We have one here at the base of the tent. And then we have one here in the very back of the tent, about 3 feet up. So you can see here on the floor inside, it's 29 degrees. So we'll fire this stove up and show you how hot it gets. Okay, I'm gonna baton some wood up here. This wood is really got some really, it's a really hard wood. It's got a lot of sap in it. I think it'll, I'm not sure exactly what type of wood is. It almost looks like an ash, but I'm not positive. It does have some lentils in it, but we'll baton some up here and get some up small enough to start a fire, and then we'll give you an update of how much how hot this gets. This is another nice reason to have an open spot at the front of the tent. You can put a chopping block down, baton all your wood up. If I have to, I can get my Wetterling's axe and I can chop right here if I have to.
Stove pipe. Okay, we're gonna start our fire. I put my wood across at an angle like this, and then I put some wax balls, cotton balls, and I even got a little bit of fat wood that I'll split up and put back in there between those pieces.
It causes a draw across the wood to the stove pipe over here. The flue is right about here, and there is a hole in the back behind the baffle. So you can see the baffle here, so the wood will draw back that way across this wood and light it up. That way I don't get too much puff back inside the tent. It minimizes the amount of smoke. Sometimes I'll light a lighter in here to see if I have an updraft, but I can feel that I do. So we're going to go ahead and light this up and start a fire.
All right, we'll light this up, push it back in there, and we should be good to go. Well, you can see how hot that first section of stove pipe is getting. I'll give you some heat temps on this later. You can see it's glowing red. And That's not with a lot of wood in there. That's with, still with the same wood that I started the fire with. Let's go see what it looks like outside. It's all, you can already feel it warming up in here. Okay. You can see, I try to get my stovepipe to be at least 2 foot above the center of the tent. But when you're snow floating a stove that may sink down in the snow, you may want a little more. And because it's windy, I went ahead and put my spark arrestor at an angle so we can get a Venturi effect and pull the smoke away, and pull the air away, as opposed to getting a downdraft if it was pointing straight up. Normally I'd run that spark arrestor straight vertical, but in this case we'll go ahead and face it downwind so it produces a Venturi effect. Some gumbo, that looks pretty good, and some rice. You can see this is on the warming tray and it's a boiling right there. Oh yeah, good old gumbo soup. Here's my Dave Canterbury cup full of some gumbo and my toke spoon. Bon appetit. Okay, I chopped up some more wood, so we should have enough wood to get us through the night. The stove's been doing very good. It's really warm in here. You can see I brought a CO meter and the CO level is at zero. You know, if I were to open this thing up a little bit, you know, you would see this level come up. There goes 11, 18, 20, 24, 38. We're at high levels of 55 now. So it's pretty important to just keep your, you know, your levels down, and you can see it dropping as soon as the stove is closed. Now we're at 6, 0. So, you know, if you're gonna use one of these stoves and you got your family in it, it's important to carry one of these CO meters. They weigh about 5 ounces, and you know, peace of mind. You know, you also have to worry about low levels of oxygen and burning off your oxygen in here, so making sure you have good ventilation is very important. Give you some temps just to give you an idea of what kind of heat we're producing in here. Right now that's 350 degrees towards the back. We're at 460 degrees almost towards the back. So this thing's producing quite a bit of heat. Our tray is in the 100 and you can see it's around 150 to 200 depending on where I hit it. And our stove pipe, you can see 300 going up to 230, 150 towards the top, we're at 120, and going out we're at around 100 degrees. So this stove jack is rated at 575 degrees, so even if I have a flare up the pipe, we're not gonna have an issue. On the floor there, it's 39 degrees. With 61% humidity, because we're just basically sitting on the floor, so the humidity is coming right off of the snow as it's melting. Number three, the 3 foot way up is about 50 degrees and 15% humidity, so you can see the humidity's dropped way down. Outdoors, it's 20 degrees with 61% humidity, and between the inner and outer tent is 52 degrees with 10% humidity.
Okay, it's 11:30. I stoked the fire. I had to get up and use the restroom, so figured I'd go ahead and stoke it. Wasn't planning on getting up till 1, but there we go. There's our temps at 11:30 at night. It's about 1 o'clock in the morning. Okay, it's 4:30 in the morning, and it's chilled off to about 29 degrees, 30 degrees. So let me stoke the fire and get it heated up back up.
Well, it's about 7:19 in the morning, and you can see it's about 35 degrees inside the tent. The wind has been pretty strong. I'd say somewhere between 25 and 30 mile an hour winds. We had gusts maybe up to 30 or 40, and you could hear the blowing snow hit the tent, sound like
sand almost. So the wind is causing me to have to soak the fire a little more. Just stoked it, and I'll give you another heat update in a few minutes just to show you how fast this tent can warm up. 719 right now. Okay, it's been about 20 minutes. You can see that we're up to 57 degrees at the top of the tent and 54 degrees at the midway and 40 degrees on the ground, about 20 degrees outside. 73% humidity, and you can see the humidity other than on the ground is not bad at all. So it's warmed up pretty quick, and it's really radiating, so it'll warm up into the probably around 65 here in just a few minutes. So I got a water bottle that spilt on my pants here. I do have another pair of pants, but we'll hang these up by the stovepipe and see if they can dry out. This will be a good test of hanging stuff up on the pole to dry them out. We'll see how long it takes. Okay, about 25 minutes and the pants are getting dry. It's gonna probably take about another 25 minutes, but I got them set up, hung up a little bit better now so that they won't get too close to the stove pipe, but yet will dry out pretty good. I think this will work a little better. And you can see we've started some breakfast, some hash browns, some sausage, boiling some water, and you can see most of the snow's melted on the ground. Got a little bit of ice and snow there, but most of it's melted. So you can see under the bottom it is melted. A little bit of ice right there underneath the floats, the snow float stakes. But most of it's all melted out. Okay, we're gonna cook up a little bit of scrambled eggs. We're gonna have some of this Mountain House. This stuff's pretty good. You can see it's dehydrated. Scrambled eggs with some bacon. We'll cook that up and let you see how it goes. Okay, I got a Dave Canterbury cup here. You can see this cup is, I'm gonna make a little bit of coffee in here. You can see it has graduated marks on it for the amount of water. I've got a few Folgers bags in here. You can see this cup is designed to such that you can have a lid while at the same time having one of these hangers in it. And it works really nice on a fire. I really like this thing because of this hanging utensil and the fact that it works with a lid. When I have this on an open fire, it's very nice because I don't get ash inside the cup. So let's pour a little bit of hot water in here and make some coffee. Okay, got the coffee mixed up, a little creamer in it. I'm using the lid to keep the coffee off the snow. Just that little bit of lid right there will keep it from getting cold. And we got a nice meal. You can see that's the Mountain House eggs with bacon. We brought in a little bit of sausage and some hash browns, and Tanya cooked up some toast. Really nice meal here. Okay, the drying pole worked out pretty good. You can see I've hung my pants on these drying poles, and it's all dry. Probably dried in about 45 minutes. It's been about an hour since I did it. I do put some ties on it to make sure that it doesn't get too close to the stove. Worked out really well. Okay, you can see here on the ground here, it's 40 degrees, 60% humidity from all the snow melting up. Midway at the tent, it's 77 degrees and 21% humidity. Outside is 30 degrees Fahrenheit and it's 80% humidity.
And this would produce crystals on the inside of this tent. We haven't had any condensation crystals forming in the tent at all. And at the very top of the tent, it's 76 degrees with 11% humidity. So even with the high winds that we've had, this is staying very warm. We have no carbon monoxide in the tent. It's staying at a nice zero parts per million, and the alarm did not go off all night. The stove doing a great job of keeping in the carbon monoxide. We do not get the alarms going off. Especially with this windy conditions, the tent has a lot of airflow through it. Tanya just stoked up the firebox, and you can see our CO came up a little bit. We're at 10. That's not very bad. We open up the vent to make sure we air out everything. This should be dropping really quick here now that we got the vent open.
It's really important to have your stove far enough back where your material, your tent door can't reach the stove and burn. Having the vent right here, using the normal vent with the 18-inch stove, you can see you got plenty of room. It's not gonna hit it, it's not gonna burn. Normally we keep our tent door closed and we keep this open.
Okay, you can see we're at like 500 degrees around the stovepipe. We've got it really stoked up now. We're in the 420s. You can see we got a good boil going, and we're at 380s, 400s. The water itself is like around 220, in that range, 227. But we're all the way up to 500 at the flue and around here. So you really have to get it stoked up to get a raging boil water. But that's it would boil a little stronger than that, but we're gonna go ahead and use it. We're ready for some tea. Okay, we're heating up a little water for some tea. And you can see we've got a steak on. We're going big time tonight. Just gonna test out the four dog stove and how it cooks. Okay, the steak is done, cornbread's done. Got my Tokes tongs that I'm gonna use to eat it with. I'll use my Battle Horse Highlander with a Scandinavian cut. A little bit of pine sap won't hurt anybody. And I got a little tea. Bon appetit. In addition to the steak, Tanya's gonna cook up some of this Mountain House pasta primavera. It seems like this stuff always tastes better after you've hydrated it to put it on a grill and cook it. It just tastes a lot better. And you can see she's got it half simmering and half on the heat. You can see one side of it boiling and one side of it's just simmering. And then she stirs it up a little bit, and it just, when your stove is really super hot, this is what you have to do. Well, the pasta primavera was really good. Tanya cooked it up good, and by cooking it on the stove, it seems like the noodles and everything soften up a little more. It was really good. I'm using my Snow Peak titanium plate here and my Tokes titanium fork. Really good meal.
I stoked the fire about 8 o'clock, and now it is 10, and it's still pretty warm. Well, it's about 11:45. I woke up before my 12 o'clock alarm went off, having a hard time sleeping actually. So I went ahead and stoked it and reset my alarm for 3 o'clock. We'll check it again then, see how it looks. But actually for 46 degrees in here, it is pretty warm. The wind is starting to die down a little bit. You can kind of see the whipping. So this is fairly mild compared to what it's been. So I'll check it again at 3 o'clock and give you an update. Well, it's 2 o'clock in the morning. The wind woke me up. It's really windy, probably hitting around 40 miles an hour gust out here, but you can still see it's 41 degrees, 44 at the midway level of the tent, and 25 degrees outside. But with that wind, boy, it really cools it off in here much faster than otherwise. You can see it whipping around. There's a great way to dry out a wet glove.
how I clean out the soot with these is I just tap them together like this. You can see this is pretty hard wood. We're not getting a lot of sap in. And then I'd stick them in there. But I have not cleaned out the box yet. See, look at that. You can see this was the one at the top. Cold air gets the soot to, and the creosote to attach to the liner of the pipe. You can see we're getting a lot more out of this one. That'll prevent you from getting a flare up your pipe and potentially having sparks come out your spark reservoir. Dangerous situation. But this system can handle 575 degrees right off the top. If we got a flare up, it'd probably only get about 200-300 degrees. Top's 400 degrees. You can see it clears out pretty good. Most of that ash is from 3 days of burning.
You can see that a lot of creosote builds up in this galvanized. This swivel does have a hard time bending once the creosote gets built up into it.
Okay, you can see all the pieces of pipe are cleaned and in the stope. You can see they fit in there really nice. The only problem that I had is with this this swivel. Once it gets a lot of creosote on it, it doesn't want to straighten very well. I even replaced it. It does clean out, but I'm done with it. I'm not going to use it anymore. This piece of pipe had a hard time fitting in the stope because it just won't straighten up. Plus, there's not a ton of room. I can get it in the inside the firebox, but I just soon not have it. It makes for loading a lot easier. If you learned something from this video, like it, and please subscribe to my Ain't Tough Survival channel.